Everybody, man, I got to say this quietly, succinctly, smoothly, expeditiously, because the guy I got on the channel, I have only read about this man and seen his photos and all that other stuff. He is an icon in his community and is known nationally and internationally as a public servant, as a politician, and all the other things that he has done over the years. He is one of those guys that when he want to make it happen, it happens. And he's on strong inspirations. Things are happening for me here on the show. And it's people like this gentleman that have come on. And let me tell you something. What happened was I made a phone call to another number and he answered the phone. He said, I said, hold on, man. I got to stop doing what I'm doing. I got to stop and take this call more seriously. I cut the music down. I combed my hair, and it was a telephone call, everybody. And he went, after he told me who he was, and then he said, let's do it today. I got time today, so watch me move fast on this, my friends. I haven't even told you who I am. I'm Anthony Brogdon. I'm Anthony Brogdon, and so what happened was, some time ago, I came up with an ideal of keeping Black history alive and launched Strong Inspirations. And things are happening on the channel like this gentleman. I want you to do this. Hit the subscribe button. Hit the like button on this video. I know you're going to like it a lot. It's coming straight, no chaser. Hit the notifications bell and tell somebody about Strong Inspirations. Don't keep it to yourself. Hold on. If you don't tell nobody about no other video, tell them about this one. He is moving and grooving in his community. That I'm gonna say that. I'm not gonna say his name because you know how I do. Y'all been watching me. Y'all are my peoples. And so do this, my friend. Have y'all seen the video I did with the mayor of Brunswick, Georgia? I'm giving you a little hint. Watch that video. And the Gullah Geechee corridor, all them videos I got on here talking about Gullah Geechee. Did you see the one I did with the guy out of Montgomery, Alabama? I'm getting close to this gentleman. And he talks about, there's a couple of them on there, but one of them he talks about what really happened in the Selma to Montgomery bridge crossing. See, because they beat him up one day. 2-3 days later, they helped protect them because we had won over their hearts and more. They beat John Lewis up and a bunch of other people. They took the hits and said, okay, this is for the other people. I'll take a hit for you. And then 2-3 other days later, they helped them make their point. The guards stood watch for the watchers, the security and the state troopers. Watch that video. Did you see the one I talked about? What happened at the in Elaine, Arkansas? They had a massacre in Elaine, Arkansas. It wasn't just Tulsa, my friends. We know of Tulsa, but Elaine had a devastating situation. And did you see the one I did with the lady out of Clinton? I think it's Clinton, Arkansas. They had a devastating massacre. It's not all those kind of stories, but I'm gonna give you a couple more. Did you see the one I did with a lady out of Martha's Vineyards? Her family has owned a cottage for over 110 years and is successfully operating today. Watch that video. Did you see the one I did with one of the representatives of H.J. Russell out of Atlanta?
H. Russell.
Russell started out, his dad was a plasterer. His dad did work, showed a little Herman the ropes. And then one day he said, hey, man, I've had enough. I'm tired. You can take it over. Gave him his tools. And that brother, H.J. Russell, took that to where he was a very successful and built stadiums and apartment buildings and skyscrapers.
Yes.
Under the tutelage of his father and those others.
Yes.
Watch that video. I'm telling you, I ain't playing with you. And you're going to like this one. This guy here, he's smooth. I can tell why people voted for him. And we're going to talk about that. Nice guy. Good smile and everything. And he's in that red and white organization, too. Give him some homage.
Chris,
he's one of them they talk about. In the red and white. So, hey, watch those videos, my friends. And then just a couple more housekeepings. As you all may know, I'm a filmmaker. I took 3 years of my life and I did this movie. It's a documentary called Business in the Black, The Rise of Black Business in America. A few minutes ago, my guest said, hey, what do you know about black business? Well, I put 75 minutes of what I know in this movie. And one of the things that I talk about is slaves who own businesses. People don't know that story. They didn't tell me that in grade school. That would have made a difference in my life. I just know if my man, he's slave, and he found a way to tell the guy, he said, hey, man, let me run some operations here. There were a bunch of scenarios that went down in during that era. And there was a bunch of brothers and sisters, as you see watching my show, who took advantage and did something and made something of themselves. There were slaves who went to college. People say, how did that happen? Well, there were HBCUs open before slavery ended.
That's right.
Who going there? Former slaves. So it's streaming on Amazon. And then I went one step further and I wrote a book on it. See, now, I want people to have this book. I don't charge a lot of money. I ain't going to say how much, but not a lot at all. I don't add no commentary because I want the fact to stand on its own merit. And like there are facts in here, for example, Madam C.J. Walker worked for a black lady. There are people in here that I know you don't know their name, slaves who own businesses. I found one guy in the 1800s that could be worth $20 million in today's money.
Mm.
You don't know his name. And he's in this book. So get you a copy of this book. Every 10th book I sell, I donate one to a school. I want the kids to know. I don't want the book sitting in my basement. That makes no sense to me. I know I wrote it. I want people to get this. So go to my website, everybody, where you learn all about me. It's businessintheblack.net. Because when you in business, you want to be in the black. In the red ain't good. You want to be in the black. Now, you hear me use this term strong a lot. Strong is my favorite word. The name of the show is Strong Inspirations. The name of my company is Strong Productions. And I wish my middle name was Strong, but it's not. And I've been saying strong a long time. Strong stands for strength, tenacity, resilience, and a sense of oneness, nobility, and grace. And that is my introduction to the gentleman on today's channel. I'm super excited. Good-looking guy, too. And he's an icon in his community. He helping people. I'm sure, as you hear the story, his life has been that way. So please introduce yourself. Thank you for coming on Strong Inspiration.
Wow, boy, you are something. Give him a hand. Anthony Brogdon.
Yes, that's
strong
it.
Strong inspiration. I am Johnny Ford, former mayor of Tuskegee, Alabama for 32 years, former Alabama state legislator for 6 years, member of the staff of the United States Department of Justice for 1 year as the state supervisor of the Community Relations Service here in the state of Alabama. I now serve as a member of the City Council of Tuskegee, Alabama. And lastly, it is my honor to be the ambassador for the state of the African diaspora. Greetings, Brother Brogdon. Greetings.
Man, let me before we go into all that you do and the whole story, I got to ask a couple personal questions.
Right.
Where were you born and raised?
Born in a beautiful, in beautiful Bullock County, Alabama, Midway, Alabama. Reared in magnificent Macon County in Tuskegee, Alabama, the home of Tuskegee University, home of the flying, fighting Tuskegee Airmen, of which Coleman Young yes. was one of those flying, fighting Tuskegee Airmen. Tuskegee, the birthplace of Mrs. Rosa Parks, the Tuskegee, the home of Booker T. Washington and Dr. George Washington Carver, the home of Lionel Richie and the Commodores. You have Motown, but we have the home of the Commodores.
That's right.
So I was reared in beautiful Macon County and educated in lovely Lee County, Auburn University. Okay. I am the proud recipient of 5 honorary doctorate degrees, and so I love my HBCUs. Yep. I'm a graduate of Knoxville College, which is an HBCU in Knoxville, Tennessee.
Yes.
So I am a son of the South, born in beautiful Alabama. Okay.
Let me ask you this. Okay. Where your parents, where did they come from?
Well, Alabama, Bullock okay. County, okay. Alabama. They were born and bred in beautiful Bullock County. I am the son of sharecroppers. I am a son of the South, proud of my humble heritage. As Sam Cooke sang, I was born by the river in a little shack. I was born by the road in a little house. And I want you to know that it is good to be able to now look back upon the road that you've traveled. It's not where you come from, it's where you're going.
That's right.
Thanks to a lot of people, my uncle and aunt who adopted me at the age of 4, brought me to Tuskegee. I was reared here, and I want to thank them for raising me. At one point, I was ill as a boy, and they didn't expect me to live to the age of 30. But I am proud to say on yesterday, I reached the age of 80 years young.
That's
and I'm
good.
Still on the battlefield.
That's right.
Fighting for my people, fighting for justice and equality here in the South. Okay?
I love it. How about this? Do okay. you know where the plantation is in your family?
Yeah, of course I do. The Patterson Plantation. As a matter of fact, our Uncle Frank ran the plantation. He ran the plantation like the white plantation owners did many years ago. My Uncle Frank had a horse and buggy, and he oversaw the full plantation. My parents worked on that plantation, and I was born in beautiful Bullock County. But in my case, I had an uncle who saw me as a little boy at the age of 4 and said, "I like that little bow-legged boy," said to my mother, since she already had 4 of us that she was trying to raise. Said, "Let me keep him for a while." And that little while turned into a lifetime.
Okay.
So the point is, I am a son of the South.
Okay, I want to go back on this though. Okay, you said that they were at that plantation.
Yeah.
Yes. That plantation grew what? What was this crop?
Everything. Cotton, peanuts, sugar cane, raised chickens, hogs, cattle, horses. I mean, it was a full-fledged plantation, the Patterson Plantation, many acres they oversaw and ran as a plantation. Black folk okay. Not only served as slaves, but thanks to the Civil War being won by the North, Blacks got their freedom, and many of them were able to not only own their own plantations, but Blacks joined hands and they were able to organize their own historic towns and settlements. Many of them inspired by Booker T. Washington, who founded the National Business League in 1900.
That's
and
right.
At that meeting of the National Business League in 1901, Booker T. Washington invited Mayor S.L. Davis, who was the newly elected mayor of Hobson City, Alabama, founded in 1899 as the first all-Black incorporated town in Alabama, came and spoke to the national meeting, and he challenged Black people to go back across America and to organize their own towns, run their own towns, their own communities, especially since the Ku Klux Klan was going wild, hanging and taking the advantage of Black people. We needed to, during those days, gather together in our own communities. And so, for example, here in Tuskegee, Booker T. Washington inspired the founding of Greenwood. You've heard of Greenwood, Black Wall Street.
That's right.
Tulsa.
That's right.
Where we had the first Greenwood here in Tuskegee, where Booker T. Washington inspired the Black people, primarily those who worked at Tuskegee University, to set up their own town around the college. And so, Tuskegee Institute, Alabama, had its own post office, its own drugstore, its own pharmacy, had its own swimming pool, its own drive-in theater, had its own barbershops and automobile dealerships and grocery stores and nightclubs. And it was a place where the flying, fighting Tuskegee Airmen had a place to come when they came off the base. And so I now have the honor of serving as the president of the Historic Black Towns and Settlements Alliance. Go online and Google
yes. them. Well, we're going to talk about it. We're plugging them. I got to, don't mean no disrespect. Let me ask you, so you grew up like that. Did you, and you said initially your parents were sharecroppers.
Oh, yes, right.
So that meant they were poor. Is that correct?
Even before sharecroppers, they were slaves. My forefathers, grandfathers, and mothers were slaves, okay? And then later, they had an opportunity to be sharecroppers. But the point that I'm stressing is we have to be proud of our humble heritage and thank our ancestors for giving us a chance to live. Thank our ancestors for giving us a platform to build on.
That's right.
Thank our ancestors and our parents who brought us from a mighty long ways. But
that's
we didn't stay on the plantation.
Right.
We grew. I had an opportunity to grow up, as I indicated earlier, in historic Tuskegee, Alabama, under the sound of the plains of the Tuskegee Airmen.
Yep,
I attended Washington Public School, named in honor of Dr. Booker T. Washington.
That's right.
Went to school with the grandson of Booker T. Washington. Attended Tuskegee Institute High School, which grew out of Tuskegee University. And then with an academic scholarship and a football scholarship, had an opportunity to attend Knoxville College.
Okay.
Graduated from college and then on to New York City.
Okay.
Where I had a chance to work in New York City in Midtown Manhattan as a scout executive, raising money for scouting from foundations and corporations in New York. And then when Senator Bobby Kennedy ran for president, Earl Graves, the founder of Black Enterprise magazine, my top scouting volunteer, and invited me to join the staff of Bobby Kennedy as a political strategist. And that was my first taste of politics.
I'd actually
gone to New York to become an actor because I always loved the theater. Was studying on Broadway, but instead of becoming an actor in New York, I became involved in politics with Senator Kennedy.
Yeah.
That's a campaign that took us across this country, and I was with the Kennedy campaign in California the night that he was assassinated.
Oh, really?
Rafer Johnson and Rosie Greer and Charles Evers and John Lewis and Percy Sutton from New York and Milton Glamison and Julian Bunt. We were all there with Kennedy that June 4th in 1968.
Let me stop you there. I don't mean no disrespect.
Go ahead.
Okay,
go ahead.
So how about this? When you were a little kid, I want to go back to that. And you grew up in this small house.
As a matter of fact, a shotgun house is still standing. One of the few that's still standing. I'm going to memorialize that so that the younger generation would know what a shotgun house. A shotgun house is you can look in the front and straight out the back door.
Straight out the back door. Okay, then you went with your aunt and uncle.
Go ahead.
What did they do for a living?
What do you mean, what? Oh, my father, my uncle, who was my stepfather, the one who raised me, the late Reverend Charlie Benjamin Ford, served at the VA hospital as a nursing assistant for some 30 plus years.
Okay.
My mother, my stepmother, the late Tennessee Ford, she did domestic work in the homes of white and blacks in Tuskegee, Alabama. As a matter of fact, I was telling someone the other day, we were looking at the mansion where my stepmother worked, and it was the home of Judge Bonner, a federal judge. When I was running for mayor the first time, they had placed all the voter registration days during the summertime so that the students at Tuskegee University could not vote. But thank goodness the football team and the band and some students came back early. And so we were able to take those students downtown to get them registered to vote. But the white folk who were in charge would not register those 150 college students. So we filed a federal lawsuit that was against the Voting Rights Act, which states that if you're there on time to get registered to vote, and if you're eligible to get registered to vote, they have to register you to vote. So we filed a federal lawsuit on that Friday. It went before Judge Robert Varner, who is the same judge that my mother worked for, the same judge I was a yard boy for by cutting the lawn and cutting the bushes. It went before that federal judge. He ruled and ordered the Board of Registrars to open up that Board of Registrars on Monday. They did that. They registered 150 students from Tuskegee University. And that next day, out of 4,000 votes, I only won by 137 votes.
Oh my God, really?
Votes helped to make me the first African-American mayor elected in the history of Tuskegee, Alabama.
I love it. Okay, we're gonna stay with this just a tad, because I want my people to hear this. When you were a little kid, did you do something exceptional that somebody saw something in you? Did you, like, were you a good student and that kind of thing, or you talked to your other friends and said, "Hold on, I don't like the way things are going"? When did all this manifest in you?
Well, as a matter of fact, when I was growing up, I remember Mrs. Louise Perkins. They would be sitting on the porch, and at 4:30 on Sunday evening, we'd be playing marbles or whatever. I put down my marbles and I go home, take a bath, and put on my clothes, and I would go to the BTU, that's the Baptist Training Union, while all the other kids were still playing. And Miss Perkins said, "You see that boy there? He's gonna be something one day." That's what she said to the other ladies who were looking there.
Yeah.
And I remember, though, when I was 13 years old, I remember it. But more important than that, there are still people alive who remember it.
Yeah.
Carl Leonard, Lonnie Smith, they were there. We were standing on the outside of the city park, and we couldn't go in the park. All we could do was look through the fence and watch the little white boys and girls swimming in the swimming pool, playing baseball, enjoying themselves in the public park. We had to look through the fence. And I remember seeing a big bronze plaque on the gate to the park that said, "Mayor Frank Carr." And I said to my fellow boys who were standing there peeping through the fence, I said, "You know, the mayor of this town must be a powerful dude." And that's the term I use.
Yeah.
A powerful dude.
Yeah.
If he can keep us out of this park, I want to be mayor of Tuskegee.
There you go. All right. There you go.
so that we can open up this park so that all the children, black and white, can play in this park.
I got a big question for you.
So some, they looked at me and said, man, you crazy. You can forget about that.
Yeah.
So they laughed at me, but they still remember that at the age of 13, I was talking about becoming mayor of Tuskegee and opening it up so that. And so now today, our parks are certainly open so that all of us
can enjoy it. Have you ever been called nigger?
Oh, we were called everything but a child of God. I remember I grew up in Alabama. I grew up in a town where Sammy Young, my boyhood friend, was shot down in a service station at the Greyhound bus station in Tuskegee because all he was trying to do was use a restroom that had a sign on it for whites only. Emmett Till was not the only black person that was killed in the South. My boyhood friend, Sammy Young, we were very close because my mother worked for Mrs. Young in the house. And so Sammy and I would play together and we became good friends. But he was shot down. But being called nigger, being called boy, being called a coon, being called all of those names. But that was just like water running off the back of a duck. That didn't faze us because calling us whatever names did not stop us or did not keep us from being determined to accomplish our goal.
Have you ever been threatened?
Oh, yeah. When I ran for mayor, Robert Burton, my co-campaign manager, had a 410 shotgun in the back of his car everywhere we went. And of course, living in the South, we were constantly threatened and our lives, you know, what you had to do is make up in your mind whether or not you were gonna do this, because this was serious business.
Yeah, I can't imagine. You putting your life on the line here.
Oh, you had to be willing to give up your life. Well, first of all, remember my background was the US Department of Justice. I was a state supervisor of the United States Department of Justice. And there were times when I could not get the FBI and the U.S. Marshals to protect the civil rights leaders. Then I would put myself in between them and the crowd, knowing that if they killed me or shot me or injured me as a federal official, then the federal government would have no choice but to intervene. There were times when I'd call in for as a state supervisor. We work with the FBI, the U.S. Marshals, and others, and we had the authority to call them in for assistance whenever there was violence. They were supposed to protect the civil rights leaders, and a lot of times they were hesitant to do that. But the point is, you got to be willing to put your life on the line in this business of public service, just like the Tuskegee Airmen. They wrote the poem, "Old Black Boy," from Tuskegee. You were not afraid to go and fly and die over the skies of Anzio. So the point is being able to stand up and put your life on the line, that's part of it. It goes with the territory. You can't play with the fight for freedom, brother.
You ever seen KKK?
Oh man, all around us. Remember, I was chairman of the board for the Southern Christian Leadership Conference for the state of Alabama. My president was Reverend John Nettles. We worked hand in hand with Reverend Dr. Joseph Lowry. You've heard of his name.
Yep,
he took the
place
when Dr. Abernathy, when Dr. King was killed, Reverend Abernathy took his place. And then when he passed, Reverend Joseph Lowry became the leader. Well, we all worked together in the civil rights movement that Dr. King started. And in Decatur, Alabama, the Ku Klux Klan shot at us and threatened us. And so, yeah, the Ku Klux Klan, we grew up in Tuskegee, remember?
I got you.
As a matter of fact, Macon County at one point had more hangings than any other county in the nation, okay? But it is also the county where we elected the first black sheriff in 1966. Lucius Amerson. It is also the county where the first two blacks were elected to the Alabama legislature, attorney Fred Gray and Thomas Reed. It's also the county where I was elected as the first Black mayor in 1972. I could go on and on and on.
Yeah.
Judge Menifee, elected as the first probate judge.
Well, okay, let me ask you this then. Let me ask you this. All that happened, and you still got to go and move around and do normal stuff too. I mean, you got to go to grocery store. Were you always on alert, that kind of thing?
Well, we had obviously had security as the mayor. I had a security, you know,
all
the time. But the point is, they can't be with you all the time.
It's
the way we grew up in the South. You know, first of all, we're not afraid, okay?
You know,
you don't scare me. I'm at home. You know, so it's that, you know, it,
yeah,
we can't play with it, okay?
I got you.
Nobody, we cannot scare the white folk or Black folk or anybody else down here, you know. Bring it on, brother. We're not.
So let me ask you this. You might have, you knew who was the KK Clay. You knew who the guy was, the
policeman. Well, they have on hoods. Remember, they put on their hoods during the
march
and all that.
Yeah.
But we knew probably some of them walking around as a local business people or bankers or whatever, but that's
let me move up the timeline. I'm moving up the timeline here. When you ran for mayor, who did you run against?
I ran against C.M. Kiva. I remember Chester Higgins Jr., famous photographer for Jet Magazine, kept taking my pictures. He said, "You know what?" He said, "You are a Black man, interracially married at the time. My sweetheart and my wife happen to be white. So here you are, an interracially married man. You are running against a white man, C.M. Kiva, mayor of Tuskegee, and you're running in a Black city, Tuskegee, Alabama. You know what? If you win this election, I'm taking all these pictures because these pictures are going to be worth something someday." But seriously, the point is, we decided at a long time ago that we were going to stay in the South. We were not going to leave the South. And if there's anybody who didn't like it, then that's their problem.
I got you.
We were born in the South, reared in the South.
You.
And we were at home. So we helped to change the South, okay?
Did some white people vote for you?
Oh, yeah. Some of the younger progressive whites who moved back. As a matter of fact, we had a coalition of younger brothers and sisters, white brothers and sisters, who were part of our team. But of course, there were many of the old line whites who obviously voted for C.M. Kiva. And you also had a lot of Black folk. The way that I was able to win, having been a political strategist for Senator Robert Kennedy.
Yeah.
And I knew how to organize a political campaign to get a cross section of people to support. I had church people, I had young people, I had grassroots people, I had people from the university who were progressive. But there were also a lot of Black folk who didn't vote for me because they thought it was too soon. And there's a lot of them who just thought the white man's sugar was sweeter than theirs.
Yeah, right.
So who didn't vote for me. But that's okay.
Yeah. We
put together a coalition. Remember I told you about the football team and those college students?
Yep.
We put together a coalition of young people. We put together church people. We put together younger progressive whites who had come back, and we put it together. My mother and father, their colleagues and others, and my daddy supported me and others. So we were able to win by 147, I think it's 147 votes that first go round, okay?
What was your slogan? Do you remember?
Well, here's the thing that really, you've heard of the infamous Tuskegee syphilis study, right?
Yes.
That study broke in the summer of 1972. We learned that the federal government had used 600 Black men as guinea pigs to determine the effects of syphilis on the human body.
Right.
They had denied treatment for those Black men when it was discovered that syphilis could be cured with penicillin. Yet they were denied treatment because they wanted them to die so that they could see, do an autopsy on their bodies to determine the effects of syphilis. Well, when that broke, I then took the position in my campaign that if you elect Johnny Ford, mayor of Tuskegee, Alabama, never again would we allow the federal government, the state government, or any other governmental entity to come into our community and take advantage of our people. That became the background and that became the foundation of our campaign.
Oh, I got you.
Never, no, never again would we allow white people or anybody else to take advantage of our people. And so that is one of the things that helped us become victorious in 1972. I'm a product of that Black National Convention that was held in Gary, Indiana in 1972, 50 years ago. So I am celebrating now 50 years of public office.
I'm celebrating
this month 80 years of life, when I thought one time that I would never live beyond the age of 30.
Let me ask you this. When you won, what did you do that night?
We celebrated. What did you mean?
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, my campaign was, we are free, free, as Dr. King is not the only one who said free at last. But the point is, Tuskegee, it was a liberating experience for Tuskegee, a town that was majority Black, the town where Booker T. Washington founded Tuskegee University, the town where Dr. George Washington Carver created more than 200 products with the peanut and the sweet potato.
That's right.
The town where the Tuskegee Airmen demonstrated that they could fly.
Right.
All of this time, this town had been ruled by a white man and by the white power structure. But now, with the election of a Black man, Tuskegee was liberated.
Let me ask you this. I don't mean no disrespect.
You asked, what did we do?
We
celebrated. The town erupted with hallelujah, free at last, free at last.
What were some of the early policies and actions that you took as mayor?
One of the things that we did was we encouraged people, in the words of Booker T. Washington, to not just flee, but to cast down their buckets where they were here in Tuskegee. One of the first things that we worked on is trying to attract more business to our area. We also went after many federal dollars. I had contacts with the administration in Washington. And then, of course, we dealt with George Wallace at the state level to get our fair share of state dollars. Getting federal monies into our town helped us pave our streets, run water lines and sewer lines, develop our airport, develop our industrial park, build a new water filtration plant on the river, to build wastewater treatment facilities so that we could expand our community, build housing, public housing, as well as privately owned housing and construction, to develop programs for our senior citizens, recreation for our young people, to develop Tuskegee as a tourist town with all of our history and culture, Black history and culture, to promote it as the town, the birthplace of Rosa Parks.
She was
born in Tuskegee, but she came to Detroit in later years to live.
That's right.
So you asked, what did we do to do during those early years? We hit the ground running, and our goal was to redevelop Tuskegee, where Black people and Black neighborhoods had been denied, had no lighting in the Black community, no paved streets in the Black community, no running water, no sewage. We got federal dollars to help develop those.
Did white people leave?
Now, some did, but some also came back. The whole idea was to improve the quality of life for our community. And so, not only did I do what I could do for the city of Tuskegee, but what we were doing in Tuskegee also became a model for other towns. And so I'm the one who had the opportunity to organize the Alabama Conference of Black Mayors when there were eight Black mayors elected mayors of cities in Alabama. Yours truly had the opportunity to organize along with Mayor Charles Evers, the brother of Medgar Evers, the Southern Conference of Black Mayors. And from there, we joined hands with Marion Barry in Washington and Tom Bradley in Los Angeles and Coleman Young in Detroit. In Harold Washington in Chicago, and we organized and expanded into the National Conference of Black Mayors. At one point, 6 out of the 10 largest cities in America were cities headed by Black mayors, and I had the opportunity of serving as the third president of the National Conference of Black Mayors.
Okay,
And then I went on to Africa and joined with our brothers and sisters in Africa. And we organized the World Conference of Mayors, Conference Mondiale des Mayors. And so today, we have the World Conference of Mayors, which I now serve again as president of the International Conference. I also have the honor of serving as the president and as a founder of the historic Black Towns and Settlements Alliance. I want you to Google that because yep. It was Booker T. Washington who remember I said earlier, who inspired Black people to organize their own towns and Black settlements across America.
I love it.
So we are the voice now of more than 1,000 historic Black towns and settlements, towns like Edenville in Florida, the first Black incorporated town in Florida, Princeville, North Carolina, the first incorporated Black town in North Carolina, Mount Bayou, the first Black incorporated town in Mount Bayou, Mississippi. Grambling, incorporated in 1953, but founded in 1901 when Booker T. Washington sent Charles Adams to found Grambling Union University. Prairie View, Texas, the home of Prairie View University. Langston, where I recently reorganized the 13 Black towns in Oklahoma. Nicodemus, Kansas, where it is a major historic Black town in Kansas, and also where you have Kansas City, Kansas, that has a Black mayor. So I could go on and on
Sure,
since you're interested in Black history and culture.
Yep, that's right.
That's what we are about. Yep. We are proud of our African-American heritage and our Black heritage and culture. We are the descendants of kings and queens, sharecroppers, and being slaves is just a fork in the road. It's just a temporary situation that our people were involved in. We are the descendants of pharaohs and kings and queens of Africa. And now today, we've demonstrated that we are a people, a proud and a prestigious people. Of people who've had one of us serve as president of the United States of America.
That's right.
We can do anything but fail. We put our faith in God and we don't let anybody turn us around.
Let me ask you this. I don't mean no disrespect. When you first became mayor,
right?
Like here in Detroit, one of the early things that Coleman Young had to do was do something with the police force.
Yeah.
And do what he could to change that attitude, the way they treated Black people. Was that also something that you had to get rid of?
Yeah, we did too. We did, but in my case,
that kind of stuff.
Yeah, in my case, my first Black chief of police was Raymond Tapley. So we hired a Black chief of police, but we had a Black chief of police even before I became mayor. Okay.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, and also remember we worked to elect Lucius Amerson, the first Black sheriff in the South since Reconstruction, was elected right here in Tuskegee, Alabama. I told you about how my friend Sammy Young was shot down using a restroom that had a sign on it for whites only. So we did something about the police and the sheriff's department. We elected Black folk to those positions, okay?
Oh, I love it. Has there ever been a riot in Tuskegee?
Well, here, when they killed Sammy Young, my boyhood friend, he became the first Black college student to die in the movement in 1966. the students from Tuskegee University rioted. They took that, they marched on downtown, they set fire to the businesses, they threw rocks, and the other thing that they did, the Confederate statue, they tried to pull him down, couldn't pull him down, so they painted his face black and a yellow stripe down his back. And so, yes, there have been riots in Tuskegee, but not the kind of riots you have in those northern cities. In this case, it was African-American students who rose up when one of their own had been shot down. But the point is, we now live in Tuskegee, Alabama, a town that is the home of Tuskegee University,
right.
Home of the VA hospital, which in 1923 became the first Black hospital in America for Black veterans. We are a tourist attraction, this town. We're the town, the home of Fred Gray, who was recently given the Presidential Medal of Freedom, who was Martin Luther King's lawyer and Rosa Parks' lawyer. And so Tuskegee, we invite all of you to join us. As I said, I served as mayor for 32 years. I've now moved up to the city council. And we now invite all of you to join us here in Tuskegee. I'll never forget at the funeral for Rosa Parks, Mrs. Parks, her three mayors were present. Mayor Bright, the mayor of Montgomery, Alabama. You know her story about Montgomery, Alabama. And Kwame was mayor of Detroit at that time.
Right.
Yours truly, I was mayor of Tuskegee, her hometown. She always called me a hometown mayor. So let me conclude by saying I want to thank you, Brother Anthony, for giving me this opportunity to spend a few moments with you. And we invite you to join with us. I'm glad to know that you are familiar with the National Business League, headquartered there in Detroit with Dr. Kenneth Harris. So I'm glad you are concerned about Black business, because we, Black business, the success of our Black businesses is so important to the survival and the future growth of the Black communities. We must have economic freedom and economic success. Black business must not only survive, but must thrive. And so the National Business League, since its inception, has been committed to that. And I'm working hand in hand with the president of the National Business League. And I'm glad to know that you too are interested in Black business. And I encourage people to read your books, because your books are the gospel when it comes to Black business.
That's good stuff there. You know, I like it. Let me ask you, did your parents see you?
They had a chance to see me.
How proud they are of you over the years.
They did. And everything. Yeah, they were on the platform. I got a picture of my mama smiling. My dad was there, so they had a chance to see their boy in City Hall. My dad would always call up to City Hall and talk to the secretary and say, hey, let me speak to my boy, okay? I was always his boy.
You're proud of yourself too, aren't you?
Well, I'm just an humble servant. I thank God for being able to see 80 years. You know, as I said, I was never expected to live beyond 30.
Yeah,
because
that's good.
The sickle cell trait and disease is in my family. And as a boy, I had much difficulty with the sickle cell trait. Caused internal bleeding for me, and they couldn't stop it for a while. So as I said, they never expected me to live. And so I was always a young man in a hurry.
Yes.
But I grew out of it, thank God.
And that's beautiful.
I hope that there'll be a permanent cure for sickle cell.
Yes.
But I was fortunate and I was able to grow out of it.
I love it.
So 30 years turned into 80 years.
That's right. I got one more question, and this is the one you're like, what Bible verse, and this is going to close us out, do you follow? If there's anyone that you follow that's been your mantra.
And Jesus wept. That's the shortest verse That's the shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. And the significance of that is if Jesus, with all power in his hand, could wept, could weep and be humble, so can we. There is strength in humbleness. There is strength in being willing to be human and to weep and to share and be compassionate and understanding, particularly when others are faced with sadness and lose loved ones. That's my favorite verse. And they always ask, say what your verse. That's the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus will.
Love it. Thank you so very much for coming on with me on the short notice as we've done this and expounding on the thoughts that you have.
Thank you.
Telling us about yourself. Hey, you let me say everybody, he bragged on himself because he got something to brag about.
Well, Anthony,
I know you ain't gonna agree to that, but you got something to brag about. You've been in high heights from the humble beginning.
Well, I'm thankful. It was always, President Lincoln said, they can write about me, said, never has a man started so low but rose so high. And I didn't rise high. I just rose to a position where I was in a position to help somebody, to help people, to give them a hand up and to lift them up. And I'm proud of what I've been able to do in my various public offices. I didn't get a chance to talk to you much about what we've been able to accomplish, but we're proud of what we have been able to accomplish in public life for the last 50 years. Yeah, and what we've been able to do to help other towns, you know, as the president of the National Conference of Black Mayors and as the president of the World Conference of Mayors, and also now as the ambassador for the state of the African diaspora, as an ambassador.
Yeah.
So it's been a life of service. That's what I'm proud about.
Everybody, that's what we do here at Strong Inspirations. We let the people do the talking as best I can. and he knocked it out the box.
All right.
Hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, hit the notifications bell. One more thing. When you come to Tuskegee, is there a big festival that is like your Emancipation Day or anything like that that people come to?
As a matter of fact, we're having all Macon County today. That's why I've got all my white and my...
I got you.
We're out in the park in downtown Tuskegee. We got hundreds of school children. They're going back to school, but we bring them to the courthouse and to the history center so they can know more about their history and their culture. And so we're having all Macon County Day. And then we also celebrate on the 4th of July because that's the day that Tuskegee University was founded. The country was founded on July 4th, but also Booker T. Washington founded and Lewis Adams founded Tuskegee University. On a Memorial Day weekend, we have another festival because that we host what will become known again as the largest gathering of Black pilots. The Tuskegee Airmen come back to Tuskegee. There's not many of them left yet. Not many of them left still.
Right.
But we have the Black pilots come in during Memorial Day. We have a big fly-in and that kind of thing.
I love it. I love it. And Emancipation Day in Tuskegee is what?
Well, that's what I'm telling you.
Yeah.
We have the 4th of July for Tuskegee University.
Yeah.
But for our city itself, we celebrate the founding of Tuskegee Institute on Founders Day, Tuskegee University on Founders Day.
That's
celebrated at the university itself each year.
I'm coming down one day.
Come down during Memorial Day.
Yep.
You can come down during Labor Day.
Yep.
You can come down during Homecoming. That's a great day.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
And the university has its great homecoming, the parade, and all of that. Listen, we have a lot to celebrate. So we celebrate every day in Tuskegee, Alabama,
man.
Because we are the home of Tuskegee University, the pride of the swift growing South.
Okay? There you go. I got one more. I know you're running, and everybody, and it's going to take a second.
What?
Happy birthday.
Okay, thank you, my agent.
Happy birthday.
Okay, thank you.
Everybody, hit the subscribe button on Strong Inspirations. Hit the like button on this video. Hit the notifications bell. Tell somebody about Strong Inspirations. Do that for me, my friends. And to you, my brother, I say this, and I mean this with all sincerity. I want you to stay strong, stay safe, stay on your grind. Give us another 20 more years at least.
All right.
Doing the work that you're doing. We love it. We love that you have come from your beginnings to your heights, and you have stayed humble in between that process, and you keep doing it for strangers.
Well, listen, I didn't tell you, my wife is also a history maker. She is, and you can Google her, she is the Honorable U.S. Magistrate Judge Joyce London Alexander Ford. She was the first Chief United States Magistrate Judge, African-American Magistrate Judge in the United States. And she served the country 30 years on the bench, U.S. Magistrate Judge in Boston. So the two of us, the judge and the mayor, we both had an opportunity to serve mankind, and we're just blessed to have each other. And you wish me well, but I also want you to wish her well.
I do.
She's retired.
I wish her well very much.
Okay.
Everybody, with that, I'll say bye-bye. We out.
Okay. We're out.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. Peace.